Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Welcome to this morning's meeting at the Council. This is part of our CEO speaker series, and of course, as you'll know, we're delighted to have with us the chairman of Nestlé, Peter Brabeck. Great pleasure to welcome you again to New York, and in New York's premier breakfast venue, with New York's premier breakfasters ready to listen to you and to quiz you. Could I just ask everyone, please, to completely turn off, don't just put on stun, your cell phones, your BlackBerrys, all wireless devices to avoid interference with with the sound system. And I'd just like to remind all members that this morning's session is on the record. This is not one of our off-the-record occasions. So I'm joined on the stage by Peter Brabeck, the chairman of Nestlé, the world's leading food, nutrition, wellness company, with, 281,000 or so employees in how many different countries, Peter?
Well, basically, we are present in every country of the world, and sometimes this provokes quite some issues, as you can imagine. Because when sometimes Americans decide that some countries are an axis of evil, and you have some factories over there, you get into problems. So
you're everywhere.
Basically, we're everywhere, including we even have a representative in North Korea. And the reason is very simple. The reason is that we have products coming in there from basically from China, but not only from China. And we have to delegate one person in order to ensure that the quality of the product is right. So it is normally it's always in order to ensure the quality of the product. So
right.
Basically, in every country in the world, you will find somebody from Nestlé.
And speaking of the product, I hope everyone's managed to take some Nespresso coffee down at the back there. Little better than the... Well, no, sorry, I shouldn't say that, actually.
Different.
You haven't brought George Clooney with you today, have you?
No, because for one reason or the other, he just doesn't want to be in the United States for a campaign. He agrees to be our ambassador all over the world, with the exception of the U.S.
If those of you, and I'm sure most of you do, who travel to Europe frequently, will see in virtually every airport in Europe glowing pictures of George Clooney with Peter's Nespresso products. But as you say, you never see them over here. Now, in the last few years, Nestlé has been at the forefront of this extremely interesting and I suspect important development in corporate management that Michael Porter wrote about in the Harvard Business Review just a few weeks ago, actually, on shared value. And you and he, I know, have worked together for some years on this. So tell us about shared value and tell us how you came up with the idea of shared value as a driving motor force for what Nestlé does.
Well, the story is relatively simple, and I know some of you were even present when this happened. It was up in Davos. Klaus Schwab in the World Economic Forum in Davos, he had put forward as the main subject corporate social responsibility. And he invited at that time Angelina Jolie and Sharon Stone and Bono and a lot of more people, a little bit more media-friendly people than normally us. And within, I would say, hours, the 1,500 entrepreneurs who are still the core of Davos started to talk about we have to give back to society. And there was not one who would not follow in. And for 5 days, basically, we were discussing how we have to give back to society. And it was in the closing plenary that I stood up and I said, look, I've heard you now for 5 years. I will tell you something. Nestlé and myself, I don't feel that we have to give back to society. because we have not been stealing from society. Because if I have to give back something, it is because I appropriated myself something which doesn't belong to me. Otherwise, I don't have to give back. So, and this provoked, of course, a big shockwave. And I left Davos with a question in my mind. I mean, this concept of corporate social responsibility, which in its initial stage was very close to philanthropy, that this was a problem for the CEO of any public company. Because I personally believe that no CEO of a public company should be allowed to make philanthropy. I know this is shocking for the American environment, but I think anybody who does philanthropy should do it with his own money and not the money of the shareholders. I can understand very well that Bill Gates takes his money, and makes the biggest foundation, and this is great, and Warren Buffett makes this, but this is always their money. It's not the money of the companies. So out of this conviction that on the one hand, we cannot make really philanthropy, but also from a second conviction that is, which is also sometimes not really understood, that a company can only act if it has two things. It gets a license from the society it is working in, and this is many times just forgotten. It's given. I mean, in the US, it's normal that you're allowed to have a private activity. Well, if you go just not even 90 miles to the south and you go to Cuba, this same authority is not given. Mm-hmm. And if you go to Venezuela, it's not given. And in many countries of this world, it was not given. So we should not forget that as a company, we receive a license to be able to do our work from society. And the second thing you need, of course, is the money which you get from the shareholder. So out of this came the consideration that it is not enough for a company just to create value for the shareholder, because you are covering one aspect of the licenses you receive. You also have to create value for the society at large, which allows you to act. So out of this, then I read the article from Michael Porter, his first one.
Yeah, the very first.
Which was Corporate Social Responsibility and Competitivity. So I read this article, and he had already in this part this saying that corporate social responsibility can be a competitive enhancer. It doesn't have to be a confrontation, which it was being seen many times in the past.
Or but, just a pure cost, indeed.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
As a matter of fact, I mean... In 5 years ago, still, corporate social responsibility, by this we have to give back to society, was an additional cost.
Right.
It was an add-on, yeah, and it was in a balance sheet under the cost item, frankly speaking. So I got in contact with Michael, and we started to discuss my idea about this. I don't have to give any back to society, and him talking about competitiveness, corporate social responsibility, and we started to evaluate. And I asked him to make an independent analysis of the value chain of Nestle in Latin America. He went together with Michael Kramer, his associate in this thing. They analyzed our value chain in Latin America, came back, and we produced a public report, which became public, on what is the impact on society of a company like Nestle in a whole continent. And from there onwards, we then started to create the word creating shared value as a new concept of corporate social responsibility. Out of this, I created an creating shared value advisory board where 13 of the most famous NGOs are present. Michael is also a partner there, but I mean sustainability, a lot of birds there, a lot of people are there, which helped me constantly in order to refine this concept. And finally, he published in January the new Harvard Business article, Creating Shared Value, where he gives the more, I would say, scientific background to this idea, which in our case, it's of course more a pragmatic one as a business proposition.
And as both Michael Porter wrote in that wonderful piece in the Harvard Business Review, and as you've been saying for the last few years. The distinction here is not as an add-on function to corporate objectives, but rather a key corporate internalized strategic objective.
Yeah, I think this is a big difference. What it does, it integrates the corporate social responsibility of the company into the strategic thinking and decision making of the organization.
Right.
Okay? And I can give you a very short example and how it can happen and can be positive for both. If we built a factory, we made an analysis, value analysis. If we built a factory, for example, close to a city in Europe, or we built a factory somewhere in the developing countries, the fact that we built it somewhere in the developing countries in a rural area has an enormous impact of value creation for society in this country. Because in most cases, the people are not there. So before we even start with building the factory, we have already to train people. We need mechanics. We need electricians. We need this small places many times doesn't have a wastewater treatment.
Right.
So we built the wastewater treatment for our factories, and we allow the whole village to put the wastewater into the thing. So the value that you create is absolutely stunning when you start to valorize this. Now, you can ask, but where is your shareholder?
Right.
Well, the shareholder is, because it also happens that if you are in this rural environment, the land is much cheaper, the labor is much cheaper, and so that basically...
Your supply chains are shorter.
The supply chain is shorter.
Right.
So basically, the value creation for the shareholder is not in conflict with the value creation for society. And on the contrary, it can even be, for both of them, very positive.
I've been interested in the amount of work you've done in this context on cocoa, and particularly in Cote d'Ivoire, a nation that, of course, is sadly in the news at the moment. But the whole cocoa initiative has always struck me as very interesting.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, we have been working on the cocoa initiative for many years. We have, as a matter of fact, we never had plantations. I mean, that's
right.
Perhaps a difference to some other multinational companies who come from a different background. But of course, Switzerland never had a colony, so therefore we never had has this past. Right. So we never had plantations, but what we did and what we are still doing is working very closely with the small farmers all over the world. We are working today with more than 600,000 farmers directly, and we are going to increase it substantially. Cocoa being one, we are one of the biggest cocoa users of the world, of course. Cocoa had a part of the normal agricultural challenges, which has to do with the quality and the hybridization, and therefore not getting the same yield or not getting the same quality. So there are those issues which we can help. But cocoa had another very bad issue, which is basically child labor and slave labor in some African markets. Mm-hmm. And this was a challenge which is not very easy to tackle. We started to launch some programs. But if you ask me today, in some areas, and without mentioning any country, this has not been resolved completely.
There's still work to do.
Still work to do. Right. Because it's, on the one hand, there is a very fine edge, which is difficult, and this is, of course, child labor in agricultural environment is almost natural. I mean, I always say the same thing. You go into Switzerland, we are in a wine-growing area, for example. Well, still today, in the months of September, schools have 1 week holiday so that the children can help in the wine harvesting. Yeah? Now, in Switzerland, this is absolutely right. Correct. So in those developing countries, this also happens. So you cannot only say, no child should ever be working in the rural environment because this is almost impossible. So you have to look at differently. What you have to assure is, and what we try to assure is, that those children have access to schooling. So we are not anymore saying, to the parents, you are not allowed that your child helps you in harvesting coffee, which is ridiculous. But what we are saying is, we will help you that your child has access for schooling.
Right.
Okay. So we pay a premium if they can prove that children goes to school, for example.
Now, rural development as a whole is one of the three, I suppose, kind of big areas on which you've tried to develop shared value programs. Rural development, water, and you had a op-ed in the Wall Street Journal yesterday, and a nutrition. Actually, tell us a little about the piece that you had in the Wall Street Journal yesterday on the fair pricing of water, because I think a lot of people who don't know the economics of water would look at that and say, well, Nestle, or the chairman of Nestle, is calling for the privatization of water supplies, which was not actually your point, was it?
No, absolutely not. But let me perhaps just put it in the in the frame. You see, just to finish with creating shared value, one thing that one has to understand, that creating shared value is not hanging alone in the air. Right. For me, the first and fundamental thing of before you get to creating shared value is, of course, compliance. I mean, that's a bottom of the pyramid, of the value pyramid, of the corporate social responsibility. The first thing a company has to do is to comply with the laws of the society they're working in. It has to comply with its own codes and regulations, and it has to comply also, very importantly, with your own set of values that you have established for your company. And this is fundamental. Once you have complied, there comes a second point, which is also important before you get to creating shared value, and this is a sustainability aspect. If we want to have our company that is going to celebrate the 150th birthday very soon, if we wanted to project another 150 years, we have to be using the resources that we need in such a manner that we are not only getting the resource today, but that we are assuring today that we will have resources in 150 years. So there's a sustainability aspect, part of corporate social responsibility. And only then can you really think about creating shared value. And within the creating shared value, it is my belief that every company has to really analyze its situation where it can optimize this common value creation. Now, in the case of Nestle, and this was a work together with Michael Porter, we decided that the biggest opportunities we have were in the area of nutrition, because we are the leading nutrition, health, and wellness company, in the area of water, and in the area of rural development. But as much as creating shared value is a concept that is absolutely open for everybody, and we are trying, and I'm very happy to say that already several of my competitors have embraced this idea, each one has to make its own decision and its own analysis where they can really optimize this creating shared value. So this brings me back now to the three areas. Why these three areas? Water was one of them. And water was one of them because it's another 5 years, more or less, that I approached in Davos again. I approached this subject of water. And as a matter of fact, there were 8 people, 10 people in the room who were interested in the subject of water, because it was basically thought that this is not really important. Sure. Well, it turned out that if you really look into the figures, we are going to run out of water much before we are going to run out of oil or of energy or something like this, or long before we are going to have an impact of climate change. I mean, we are talking in climate change 100 years. We are talking on the energy side. The U.S. has today proven reserves for the next 200 years if you take oil and gas together. So, I mean, yes, it is an issue in the long term. But the problem of water is an issue of today. We are already today overusing, over the last couple of years, more than 300 cubic kilometer of water, which is about 10%, 8 to 10% of total water withdrawal, which is overused. And who pays for this? The one who pays for it is the environment. Yeah. Yeah? Because this misusage that we have of water, and we are misusing water in the most incredible manner, is being paid by the one area that needs water, which is environment. So you have, give an example, there are 5 of the biggest rivers are not bringing water anymore to the sea for more than 4, 5, 6 months. Okay, you have the Aral Lake, which 25 years ago, cities which were port cities, today are 120 kilometers away from the water in 25 years. Okay, basically because we are overusing water. Now, who is overusing water? The biggest water consumer is, of course, agriculture. 92% of total fresh water consumption goes into agriculture. It's very interesting. Most people talk about the water we are drinking. Mm. Well, let's suppose we are drinking 5 liters of liquid, of water based, which is our hydration. What people don't understand, that we are eating every single day. In the U.S., I would say, in the East Coast, perhaps 4,500 liters of water. When you go to Texas, you're at the 6,500 liters of water. Because you need 1 liter of water for any calorie that you eat. If it comes from a plant, and you need 10 liters of water for any calorie that you eat when it comes from a meat. So you have a multiplying effect of 10 between plant and meat. Therefore, the Texans need a little bit more water, eat a little bit more water steaks. So that's the first thing. The second thing is then, of course, industry. And in the industry side, it is mainly and very much so for energy production. Mm. So there's a nexus between energy, water, and food. And the last part, and the minimum one, is really for what most people talk about, and which I also talked in this one open-ended, which was published yesterday, which was then the household consumption. And in the household consumption, the water that we really drink is about 1.5% of the total freshwater withdrawal. Okay, the rest of it, 9.9%, basically goes into toilet, showers, car washing, garden thing, and things like this. Okay, so those are the issues. Now, in the household one, we have unfortunately a situation. Just talking about waste, where in the developed countries, about 30 to 35% of all water is being lost due to leakage, basically, right. Not sufficient infrastructure. And in the developing countries, it's up to 70% of the water is just being lost because there's not sufficient infrastructure. We need, in principle, a budget of about $500 billion U.S. dollar worldwide in order to get this infrastructure in place. But unfortunately, this is not the first priority for nobody. And again, I had thought that when these infrastructure projects would be launched, for example, in the U.S., that water would get a priority. Right. It didn't get any. Right. As a matter of fact, Washington, D.C., okay, made the decision, which is on the Internet, I saw it on the Internet, not to spend $124 million to renovate its water infrastructure and allows today to have the old pipings full of plumb, right. Which are basically poisoning us. And the argument was on the Internet that this water poisoning was not so important to justify $124 million of dollars in Washington, D.C. to put this infrastructure into place. Okay? So you see with what value we give to water. Basically, for us, water has no value at all.
Whereas, in fact, it's a scarce resource. And so
it is the most valuable thing that we have in the world. Right. And yet we don't give him a value. That was basically the idea about the article. It was not really tackling the most important one. I did another one with Klaus Schwab and OpenMind, which were more talking about the whole water situation. This one was really trying to give value to the price to the water. Frankly speaking.
Here in New York, I have to say, we regard ourselves as having the best water in the whole of North America, and we are, as I speak, building a massive infrastructure project.
Yeah, which is good, but 64 water. Million of Americans don't sure. have access. 64 million of Americans don't have access
right.
to good water.
Right.
It's quite a lot of people. It's quite a lot of people.
Let's get some questions in for Peter Brabeck while he's with us this morning. While you're thinking of questions, let me just your latest report on shared value is about rural development. Tell us some of the work that you're doing there. You've touched on what you do on education, things like that.
Well, you mentioned in the beginning we have 281,000 people working directly for us. We have 600,000 farmers which are working exclusively for us. And we have about 3 million of people who have their income depending on us. So, I mean, it's quite a big responsibility that we have behind. So if you look at the social challenge, you will see that the hungry people of this world are the farmers. This is another, at least for me, was quite eye-opening, because we believe that when food prices are going up, raw material prices are going up, that this is good for the farmers.
Right.
The truth is, this is for the small farmers one of the worst things. So you have in the rural population 90% of the poorest of this world are in the rural part of the rural population, and therefore we have said it is good for us and it's good for society and for our shareholders if we help this poorest part and give priority to them. People in cities, normally politicians take care of them because they fear them, okay? Right. Because they are very concentrated vote and they fear them. And what happens in the Middle East, I think it's a good sign. If you look why most of the Middle East upheaval came was an increase of food prices, okay? In the urban area. But frankly speaking, very few people care about the small farmers. Most politicians care about the big farmers. All subsidies, if you look at subsidy, I mean the amount of subsidies which is going, most of those subsidies goes to the big farmers because all the subsidies are volume related.
Yeah.
And who produces a big one, it's the same. So the enormous amount of small farmers basically have no real voice and are those ones that are suffering most. And that's why we decided that we wanted to work with them and in order to help them to get out of this misery, which allows us, first of all, to get an assured supply, to get the quality that we need. And secondly, it also allows us, if they have more access, they become automatically our best consumers, so our best customers. So again, it helps us. Every farmer that has more income will afterwards buy a Nescafe or will buy a Nesquik for the children or something like that. They also become good customers of ours. So it helps both sides very well. So that's the reason why we have been concentrating on this area.
Let's see if we can find some questions. Gentlemen over here first, please identify yourselves when you ask the question. Here, and then lady there, and then over there.
Yeah. David Vidal from the Conference Report. There was another article in the HPR recently, or maybe a couple months ago, by Dominic Barton. I don't know if you got to see that one. Where he addresses, I think, one of the main questions in this whole idea of shared value in terms of how it can actually happen. What Barton was saying is that there's so many structural impediments in the ways that equity markets handle the arbitration of whether or not you're creating shared value, because they have such a tremendous short-term bias, that really doing shared value requires a longer-term horizon than the incentives in the market permit. How do you propose to overcome, maybe through another project, these structural impediments that really keep most companies, which is the large majority, you guys are a leader, from doing anything like shared value because the markets just won't let them?
Very good.
Well, that's a very, 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 very interesting question. You see, we have, from the beginning, one of this set of values that we have, which we call the Nestle Management and Leadership Principle or the Nestle Corporate Principles, we have anchored into them that we are a long-term thinking company. And it is 3 years now again that I propose to the shareholders that we should change the articles of constitution of our company, and we should put in there that we are committed to the long-term sustainable shareholder value creation. And 99% of our shareholders approved that. Now this, of course, gives the management enormous power, because we withdrew from any stock market where we were demanded to have quarterly profit and profit results. We do not publish it. Now, because I know very well that the moment you publish it, there is no way that your management is not going to be short-term oriented. Okay? And that's about the worst that there can be. if you believe in the other concept that I said. So you have to be consequent. And this was the reason why we went to our shareholders in the General Assembly, we presented them creating shared value, and we changed the Article of Association in order to be coherent. Now, this is good news for those shareholders who really have an interest in the company in the long term. It's a little bit less good news for the very short-term shareholders, hedge funds, and things like this. Now, there's still sufficient volatility coming from the outside, okay, so that they still have a place to play. But of course, it's not the same thing that if you have a company that will constantly work on short-term results, which is quarterly results. You will not get this from us.
I could see a number of people in the room listening very carefully to that one. Lady, just there, yes.
Patricia Rosenfield, Carnegie Corporation, and I want to thank you very much for what you've done, and I was at the World Health Organization and followed closely the really innovative work that Nestle took on many years ago, and I want to thank you and the company for that.
Thank you.
I want to say that what you're actually doing is philanthropy, as Andrew Carnegie 100 years ago, more than 100, in 1889, proposed it in his Gospel of Wealth. And you are following almost exactly the principles, so I'd be delighted to share that with you. We're a younger organization than Nestle's, having been set up 100 years ago, but it really is a kind of philanthropy that you're doing that is absolutely showing the linkages between private-public partnerships in the most exciting way, and so I really want to commend you for that. But it is philanthropy in the best sense of the word. And along those lines, my question is, one of the things we've learned from those of us who have worked in international philanthropy over the years is that for true sustainability, we can't do it alone. We have to work in partnership. And while you have the license from society, the most important partner, somewhat contravailing public opinion, is that we have to really figure out how to work with government and sometimes to shape government policy, to work with governments as they look at new policies. So I wanted to ask you, as part of the shared value equation, how you look in working with government beyond the licensing, which is very important as a first step, but as you invest in rural development, which is really the bugbear of development initiatives, how you look to government as your partner to sustain the initiatives that you've created?
Good question.
Yeah, thank you very much. I will not enter the question whether it's philanthropy or not. I have a different opinion, but I mean, I respect, of course, yours. But the second part of the question, I mean, it is very clear that the societal problems of today cannot be solved by anybody alone. Yeah? It doesn't matter how much money you have. You always need to have this in a partnership. So the public-private partnerships are certainly a very important part to that. Let me just give you the example of water, what we did. As I mentioned, 4 or 5 years ago, I talked about water the first time because I had made the study and I was surprised to see what the real situation was and how acute the crisis was. So I started to talk about this. I then started to talk to some of my colleagues, some of them of very important American companies, and they also understood how important this water issue has become, and we created a coalition of 5 multinational companies, which I took the leadership. We then invited the World Bank, the international finance company, and finally we engaged McKinsey, and we said, let's get a fact-based document which really gives us an argument vis-a-vis governments that something has to be done. We analyzed 154 water basins of the world in detail, because the problem is with water, it's not, you cannot, you know, 1 liter of water in New York saved doesn't help you in the Sahel. 1 kilo of CO2 not being emitted in New York has an impact, but 1 liter of water not being used in New York doesn't have an impact on things. So you have to go water basin by water basin by water basin. And we did the abatement curves of McKinsey. We looked what are the solutions for each one of the water basins, what has to be done, what could be done, and what are the costs. That was financed by us. It was done through IFC and McKinsey. And then we went back up to Davos, and we presented this. I presented this. Now, suddenly, we were about 400 people in the room, quite a lot of governments. And then I went to the most important, three of the most important countries which had an issue, and I talked basically to the president or to the minister that I could, was available, and we engaged them. And this year, we presented in Davos again, in a three-hour plenary session, we presented the results of the implementation that we have been doing with the Mexican government, Jordanian government, and the Indian government. And now we have 14 governments lined up. As a matter of fact, I go from here then afterwards to South Africa. South Africa has lined up. Then in June we go to Mongolia. The Mongolian president came to Webe and is now engaged. And we have 14 governments who are now lining up. There's one fundamental principle that I establish each time when we go into this thing. The first thing is we are not going to write policy. We are going to help, we are going to give you tools which we have worked out, but we are not going to write policy. To write water policy is a responsibility, and the only responsibility of governments should never be done by multinational companies. I mean, this would never. And the second one is those governments have to be involved. They have to pay, they have to financially participate in the cost of the project, because otherwise it's too easy. I mean, otherwise it's like in the good old time, you send them some money and then they do whatever they want with it. No. They have to finance, they have to become a partner in these things. We give all the tools, we give the intellectual work to them, but the writing of strategies and policies is always in the hands of governments. So that's basically the way we manage that.
But just to pursue that a little while, your argument and Michael Porter's argument in the HBR would be that although there are distinct roles for government, for corporations like yourselves, for civil society, what have you, all of you in the shared value movement, if you like, now agree that massive social problems cannot be solved by any one of you individually. So while you may have distinct roles, you have to work together,
yeah.
Right?
That's exactly what I'm saying. Yeah.
Right.
But I think there's another, a danger which I feel. There was a time when, also under this corporate social responsibility argument, private companies started to substitute part of the responsibility of governments. Yeah. And I think this is something that we should not be doing, and we should be very clear about this. I mean, educational reforms or water policies, or those things belong to government. And it's not for a private enterprise to substitute, even if the government's not good enough. What you have to do is to help the government to establish this role. But to try to substitute, I think, is wrong. The other aspect which is being criticized today, and I think there's also something, is when you have a very strong, financial background, that you start to put the priorities of development and development aids, and that's just happening now. I mean, there are some countries who start to be very critically about when big foundations decide, the priority for Africa is the elimination of malaria, to say some, okay? And governments have a different one. Mm. I think you have to respect, you have to work with governments in order either to convince them that this is the right priority, but not to impose them.
Right. So. question down there, and then back here, and then over there. Yeah.
Hi, Stephen Foley from the Independent newspaper of the UK. As the largest food company, you're on the front lines of food inflation at the moment, and I wondered how you weighted the different factors behind the rises of all these prices, whether you see speculation and loose money being a factor, or whether it's purely a demand issue. And I wondered how large and how dangerous you saw the consequences that might play out across the world from these rising prices.
Yeah, I mean, this is of course a very large subject. First of all, I think you have to distinguish more clearly what are the fundamentals in this thing, what is temporary, and what is, like somebody was saying, irrelevant. And unfortunately, I would say today politicians are concentrating on the absolutely irrelevant one and are not even aware of the fundamentals. Now, allow me to give you just three examples of what is fundamental, what is temporary, and what is irrelevant. Fundamental is that, first of all, we have a productivity growth in agriculture over the last 10 years, which is lower than the demographic growth. That's a fundamental. And this is new, because 20 years before, the productivity, agricultural productivity, was higher than the demographic growth. Okay? So that's the first fundamental. It's always the same. When you have demand, which is higher than supply, well, normally
prices
the market
will go
reacts.
Up. Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
That's one thing. The second fundamental is that we are running out of water. I don't have to come back to this one. And that we make some political decisions which are absolutely absurd. The fact is that you need 4,600 liters of water to produce 1 liter of bioethanol. The fact is that you need 9,100 liters of water to produce 1 liter of biodiesel. Okay? Now, again, just a sign what value we give to water. Because if water would have 1 cent of a value, you wouldn't do that thing. Okay? And yet you do. So we are running out of water where we already have problems to have sufficient water for the production of food. Today, 35% of U.S. corn goes into biofuel, which is, from an environmental point of view, absolutely a nonsense. Mm. More nonsense is it when we are running out of food for the rest of the world to put food into fuel. So therefore, fundamentally, there's only one thing to be said: no food for fuel. Okay? I give another fundamental of those things to stay with this. And I did it. I had an interview just last week with children, school children, who came to interview me about environmental aspects. So I asked them. I said, if you have a market that is 20 times bigger than the other market, and you want to substitute of the big market 20% with the small market, okay? How much does a small market have to grow that you can substitute that? They were about 8 to 10 years old. They were sitting down, and they came back, and they said, basically, you have to triple the smaller market to substitute the 20 times bigger market, 20%, which is absolutely right. Okay? Not so difficult. School couldn't do that. Now, what is our politicians doing? Our politicians tell us that they want to substitute 20% of the energy market with the food market. Both markets are calorie. Don't forget, it's the same thing. You need 2,500 calories daily in order to have your machine going, and the car needs the fuel calories in order to get the car going and the thing going. So what we are saying, what we have been saying before the first spike was, publicly, that 20% of the 20 times bigger market, because the energy market is 20 times bigger in calories than the food market, has to be replaced by the food market, which was a clear indication that the food production has to triple in order to be able to come up with the political target setting. Now, what is the result? Well, the food prices are going up. No? I mean, frankly speaking, it's not very complicated. Yeah? Mm. When at the same time you have a problem with productivity, when at the same time you have a problem with the main resource you need in order to produce this food, when at the same time you have a population growing to 9 billion, when at the same time, as I mentioned before, the Chinese and the Indian for the first time also like not only to have a bowl of rice, but a little bit of chicken and meat on top of it, with a multiplying effect on agricultural production, which I mentioned before. So those are some of the fundamentals. Okay? Now, the answer of the politicians, and I had the privilege to be the representative of private enterprise at the last G20, and I'm working with, this question is now number one priority for the G20 meeting in Nice, and the main reason is because we are going to fight against speculation. Okay. And that's a irrelevant part of it. Because speculation, the only thing it can really do is increase the volatility. Okay. Now, you can talk about volatility, but if you don't get the fundamentals in order, okay, the speculation is irrelevant. But, of course, we are concentrating on the irrelevance in this thing. Okay? And the temporary part of this is what is happening. The droughts that there were, which is true, and these are temporary effects. You had the floodings at the same time, floodings in Pakistan, floodings in Canada, the droughts in Russia, the droughts in Argentina. Those are the temporary issues which have an impact on a yearly base, but doesn't have really an impact on the long run. Now, if some fundamentals come together with some temporary aspects, then, of course, you also have a higher level of the irrelevant, which is speculation. But you will not solve the problem if you're working on the irrelevant. You have to solve the problem when you're starting on the big set. That's basically the
situation. Do you think No Food for Fuel is a campaign that is starting to get traction? Or do you think...
Let me say two things. In Europe, we have been successful in the sense that the European Parliament has now brought back the target of 20% to 5%, which was a big step forward. Okay, because perhaps we were heard more, because I was talking more in Europe about it. In the U.S., it's just the contrary.
Yeah, I know.
The Secretary of Agriculture just had made last week, I think, a statement which was absolutely flabbergasting. When he was asked about the question that now 35% of the maize goes in the thing, he said, we have sufficient maize for food, for fuel, for feed, and for export, because the U.S. is now starting to export biofuel into outside of the U.S. Not only trying to put it here, but even start to export, and he thinks he has no problem with this issue at all, and this has no problem as well. So I don't think that here we have got anything close to. I think it is absolutely immoral to push hundreds of millions of people into hunger, into extreme poverty, because of such a policy. And therefore, I think, I insist, no food for fuel. It is as simple as that. This doesn't mean that you cannot use afterwards the stems of the maize or the things, biomasses or second generation. Yeah. I personally believe very strongly, for example, the new technology of the algae, which is being produced in salt water. Yeah. In salt water, we have enough. Yeah. It uses CO2 as feed, which
we have plenty of that.
We have plenty of this. We can use that. Right. And algae produces excellent oil, by the way, both for fuel and even for food. So there are ways of this. Yeah. But what we're doing just now is absolutely non-acceptable. I'm sorry.
Very good. Gentleman here. Identify who you are, and then I think there's a gentleman at the back there.
Good morning. I'm Bill Abrams. I'm with Trickle Up, which is an NGO that works in rural development. And my question is, how do you propagate and institutionalize your philosophy within Nestle? It seems that it would fundamentally change financial systems, the way you keep score, incentive and reward systems, how you make investment decisions. So I'm curious how you build a permanent culture and permanent systems around these ideas.
Actually, let's take, there's a gentleman there who's been trying to get my attention. Perhaps we can take two questions at once. Yeah, thanks.
Good morning. My name is Jay Warren Klein. I'm with Bingham McCutcheon. My question to you is, it's very clear to me that you're focusing on some of the most basic issues, fundamental issues, such as how do you price water, no food for fuel, et cetera. So I understand that. I give you enormous credit because that could change so very much of the problems that we're facing. But when you look at today, the magnitude of the problem of access to water, both clean water and sanitation around the world, I'm wondering whether you've had any experience at Nestle in the ability for Nestle or other companies that you've partnered with to undertake the delivery of clean water or sanitation into some of the areas that you serve in a way that represents a partnership between Nestle and some of your colleagues in the business sector and governments to actually deliver through the private sector to execute? I mean, clearly the management's capability is execution compared to government's capability, which is policy formulation. I'm wondering if you had experiences in this type of sector.
Very good. Let's take how you internalize creation of shared value in your internal systems, HR, incentives, getting everyone to kind of think about it while they're doing their daily jobs. I mean, that must be a huge job, right?
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. The most important thing, especially in a company like ours, which is highly decentralized, that people during the whole decentralization steps understand and apply this strategy. First of all, we do something new, and that is we start to report about this creating shared value the same way as we are reporting the value creation for our shareholders. So if you take, for example, today our shareholder report, you have basically three documents. You have a general document which talks about what the year was. Then you have the financial reporting, which is according to accounting rules and all this stuff. And then we have creating shared value report. And we have the same transparency. For example, if you take the one that comes out here, you will have about somewhere about 120 key performance indicators that are there. For example, in the area of nutrition, we will report how many products have last year been reformulated in order to improve the nutritional profile. 6,872, I think it was last year, for example. Okay. Or how much water have we saved, how much CO2 we have been using less, how much things, how much that, etc. It's a full report, exactly like a financial report. And we have done that so that to the outside, when we are talking about creating shared value, well, this is the creating shared value for the shareholder, this is creating shared value for society. Transparent, open, clear. Everybody can look at it, everybody can discuss with us what we have achieved. Sometimes we don't achieve all what we want. We also, as I mentioned before, for example, I mean, I recognize it in the area of child labor and slave labor. I don't think we are where we would like to be. It's just today very difficult to do in Ivory Coast what we would like to do because we cannot get in there into this place. We are in Ivory Coast. We have still the factory running, but we don't get into the area where, for example, this child labor still exists. Mm-hmm. So it's very transparent, it's open. And through that, our organization understands, as we are demanding, because the top report is just an accumulation, a consolidation of all what comes in. So we are demanding the same reporting coming from the roots up, from every factory up. And this allows us also that we establish in our bonus system that the creating shared value aspect is a part of the targets that management, but even down to the local level of factory managers and factory people, get a target on creating shared value. So it is a fully integrated, transparent, open to the outside system, which allows you to follow up in the same way that we have the financial report.
And then the gentleman's question on
yeah.
On water.
There was the delivery. Yeah. I mean, what you're really you're touching on another subject, which I normally avoid to be too concrete, because especially in Europe we are being pushed and asked a lot: are you for privatizing the household water supply?
Right. Yeah?
Now, the answer is: in today's world, 3% of water supply in the world is privatized. 97% is in public hand. Unfortunately, I have to say that even there where it is privatized, the question about leakages and waste is not different to the area where it's not privatized. And one of the best, if not, I think it is even the best system, water system with the least leakage, is, at least for me, was the biggest surprise, Phnom Penh in Cambodia. And it was one person, one man, who transformed this water system, which was one of the worst corrupted in the world, transformed it into the most efficient one. There's only Singapore, I think Singapore and Phnom Penh today are the leaders in the best water system. So it doesn't have to do really whether it is privatized or not privatized. It's an aspect of management capability and willingness to give a price to water.
In fact, I think in that Wall Street Journal piece you wrote yesterday, you pointed out that the system in Cambodia wastes only a fourth of the amount that the Thames Valley system in the UK, the biggest system in the UK, which is privatized.
That's why I'm saying. So it's not a question about privatization. It's really a question about management.
Peter, you come from Carinthia, beautiful, absolutely beautiful part of Austria, and you've been climbing mountains and trekking in high country all your life. And I think you should tell people where you're going when you leave here, seeing as I was green with envy when you told me what you were going to do next.
No, I'm going to Alaska, back to Alaska. I like Alaska a lot. I think it's one of the most beautiful countries there are, and I hope I will have a good week of skiing up there.
Very good. Tell me what you've got out of mountains. I mean, you've been climbing mountains since you were a student. I know you tried and very nearly got to the top of Aconcagua, the tallest mountain in the Americas. I'm a great mountain trekker myself, so I'm not a technical climber like you are. What do you get out of being in the mountains?
Well, it is true that mountains have been always part of my life. As a matter of fact, I mean, with 2.5 years, I was on a pair of skis with my parents, and with 10 years, we were climbing on a rope because my parents already took me up, and from then onwards, it has been part of my life. So I don't make a separation between
right.
my life and the mountains. It's just one thing. And, but I think there are several things I have learned, which I have taken over for my values and the way I behave. The one is that, a very simple one, I have learned that the most dangerous thing is to come to the top of a mountain and having given 100% of your efforts. It's almost a condemnation for death. Mm-hmm. That's most of the accidents in the mountains are happening when you're going down.
Right.
That means that you have to be conscious enough. The summit is important, but the only successful mountain climber is the one who comes back to the valley healthy. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you might have been on the summit if you are dead. By the time you're down, that was not very successful.
Right.
And I think this is a little bit in business the same thing.
Right.
Yeah. I have seen too many people who are trying to give everything, just to get on top of this thing, and then afterwards they fail miserably. So that was one of the learnings.
Right.
I mean, don't if you need to give more than what you really have to get on the top, don't do it. Don't go to the
right.
top. I mean, you can still have a happy life if you don't go to the top, frankly speaking, having been on the top. Yeah. And the other thing, of course, is before you get to the top, prepare the way down. Mm-hmm. So they are not taken by surprise that suddenly you're not on the top and then suddenly you come to the thing. Well, there's a huge void in front of you because you never have thought that one day you have to go down from
yeah.
this thing, okay? Think when you go up what you're going to do when you go down and prepare the thing. And that, again. So very simple things in this sense, okay? The other thing is, and this I got from Bonnington, who was one of the most important mountain climbers, there are two different types of mountain climbers. There are this more famous one, which is this... Lonely tigers.
Reinhold Messner,
for example. Yeah, he was one of them. But there are many other of those whose only thing is they do it alone, they do it very fast, they do it and to have another thing. And then you have another type. Those are the people who can bring a group of 10, 12, 15 people on the highest summit of the world. Bennington was this type.
Sure.
And I admired him. I spent with him a lot of time because there you can learn how you're using people in different stages of an expedition. And as an expedition leader, you will celebrate that you bring two or three on the top. But you will only get them up there if all the others do their job well. And I thought this was very interesting also for your professional career. If you learn how to really take advantage of the strengths of each one of your team, and every person has strengths, but they don't have the same strengths for everything. Yeah? So some people, for example, are extremely good on the mountain in order to prepare the first building up of the first two camps. You will not use a guy whom you're going to use for the final
to
do that. Yeah. Okay. Some other people have other capabilities. They are good meteorologists. They can help you to make the right decision when you go and things like this. And the same thing is in a company. If you analyze your people, where do they have the strengths and put them afterwards in a position where they can optimize their strengths in the organization, I think you make people very happy because you let them know and you build on their strengths, and you will be more successful through a team. So that's another thing which came out from the mountain experiences.
The next session in the CEO series, CEO Breakfast here at the Council, will be Randall Stevenson from ATT. Now, there's a man in the news. You can ask him what's going to happen to your mobile phone bill over the next 6 months. Go up, I suspect. Our friends from Nestlé have got copies of a book on Peter, which I've read, and you'll hear some of these stories about mountaineering and so on, I suppose, back in the lobby back there, Helen, is that right? It's been an absolutely fabulous hour. Please join me in thanking Peter Brabeck for the time.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.